Welcome to the second lecture on module 3 for ARM microcontroller and embedded systems. So the subject code is 15EC or 17EC62. So scheme 2015 or 17, the syllabus is same. So in lecture 1 we discussed about what is an embedded system, how we define an embedded system, and how the embedded system is different from the normal or the general purpose system. And then we discussed about classification of embedded systems, then major applications of the embedded systems, and then the different purposes of the embedded system. So this is what we discussed in lecture 1. Then we came on to the general diagram of embedded system. So it is, what are the various components that the embedded system has in general. So this is the embedded system in general. So there is a system core, so which can be FPGA, ASIC, DSP, system on chip, microprocessor, microcontroller. So this we discussed in lecture 1, okay, about the system core. So the embedded system also has memory. It also has the input ports, output ports, and to the input ports we interface the sensors to collect the data, and to the output boards we interface the actuators or the output devices like LEDs, buzzers, and along with that we have communication interfaces, and then other supporting integrated circuits. So yesterday I gave an example that the supporting integrated circuits can be a watchdog timer or an oscillator to generate the clock frequency. So these are the additional circuits. So today in this lecture we shall discuss about the memory. So what are the various types of memories that are used in embedded system? So you can see the diagram. In this memory, an embedded firmware will be sitting. So what is this embedded firmware? So as I told, the name firmware means the whatever the code written cannot be changed. It cannot be changed once it is written. So that is why it is known as firmware. And we said, the lecture 1 we saw that every embedded system need not have an operating system. It may have an operating system. Yeah, so as I told, all the embedded systems need not have operating systems. So some very simple applications like a toy car need not have any operating system. It just needs some instructions or some code that is sufficient for the toy car to work. So depending on whatever the key you press, if you press the forward key, it should move forward. If you press the backward key, it should come back or move backwards. So simple instructions are sufficient, and that itself becomes the firmware for that particular toy car application. But some more complex systems may require an operating system. Okay, example is an ATM machine. So that ATM machine, if you ever seen it, whenever it is down, it is working on Windows embedded OS. So some might have seen it. So that application requires an operating system because the number of tasks are more, and to manage them, a manager is required. So that manager job is done by the operating system. So whenever the number of tasks or processes increase, so there is a need for operating system. So then the operating system is installed. So now we shall discuss about the memory. So before we start to discuss about the memory, I'll show you a memory triangle. So based on that, we'll come to know how the memory is organized in any system. So I have a picture for that. This is the picture you can see clearly here. So this is the memory triangle. So I'll start with the base of the triangle. So you can see the base is the secondary memory. So secondary memory is usually the storage memory, or you can say it is the non-volatile memory. Right? So what is a non-volatile memory? So even though you remove the power, the whatever the contents of the memory, they will not be lost. It will hold the contents. Okay, so example is your hard disk available in your computers or PCs. Or one more example is your simple memory card. So whatever you store in the memory card is available in the memory card until and unless you delete it, correct? So that is a secondary memory. And you can see it is in the base of the triangle, so indicating that usually the secondary memories are large. Okay, so the size of the secondary memory is large. Example, so you can see the example of a hard disk. So usually the hard disk come with a memory of 1 TB, 2 TB, 10 TBs, correct? So they will be in terms of TBs. So that is what is secondary memory. And why it is sitting at the basis? It is the slowest memory available. Okay, compared to all other memories, secondary memory is the slowest memory. So that is why it is at the bottom of the triangle. So next, coming to the next memory above the secondary memory, which is known as RAM, or it is also known as primary memory or working memory. It is also known as working memory or primary memory or RAM. So this is a volatile memory. Okay, so usually this primary memory will be volatile. So example is your RAMs that you use in your laptops or PCs or your mobile phones. So whatever the data there, it is, you can say whenever you run an application, so whatever the part that is required to run the application, that is brought to the primary memory from the secondary memory. So that is what will happen. And RAM will usually hold the intermediate results also, the currently running applications, whatever the data they have, everything is in RAM, but it is volatile. And one more thing you have to remember is, it is sitting above the secondary memory, meaning in the sense it is faster compared to the secondary memory, first thing, and it is, the size is less compared to the secondary memory. So it is somewhat less in size compared to the secondary memory. So usually RAMs will be in terms of GBs, not TBs, right? 1 GB, 2 GB, 4 GB, 8 GB, 16 GB, okay? So that is what. So that is the RAM. So they will not be in TBs. So after the RAM, or you can say above the RAM, so you can see the caches. Okay, what are these? These are cache memories. So they are organized into L1 and L2 caches. So these are the fastest memories available apart from the registers. Okay, so cache is the fastest memory. So it is faster than the primary memory, and it is faster than the secondary memory also. So again, they are organized into two levels, L1 and L2. So L1 is faster again compared to L2, and L2 again, you can see the cache, since it is above RAM, it is faster and it is again less in size. Usually the cache memories will be in terms of MBs, okay, 4 MB, 8 MB, 10 MB, 12 MB, like that. So not in terms of GBs but MBs. So that is what is caches. Okay, and above the caches will sit the registers. So you can see at the top of the triangle, registers. So again, since it is at the top, it is the fastest compared to all the memories. And these usually registers, they are inbuilt to a processor or a controller. They are not available outside the processor. They are within the processor or a controller. And you can see the size again. So the size is very limited. So usually the register size will be in terms of bits. So 32 bits, 64 bits, 8 bits, 16 bits, like that, not in terms of MBs also. So this is what is the memory triangle. So now first we'll discuss about the secondary memory, okay, or the storage memory. So wherein we'll store the firmware. So as I told, firmware is nothing but a software which cannot be changed. That is what is known as firmware. So a firmware for embedded system will consist of the instructions on how the embedded system should work for the various inputs that it will receive. As I told, I gave an example for toy car. So based on the key press, the toy car will move front or come back, or move right or move left, like that. So all that instructions will be written here. And if there is operating system in the embedded system, so that is also stored in the secondary memory only. So first we shall discuss about the secondary memory. So memory is an important part of embedded systems. The memory used in embedded system can either store program, okay, which is the ROM, or it can store data, which is the RAM, as I told. So ROM always stores the program or the code or the firmware and the OS, and the RAM always has the data or the intermediate results. So this is the working memory. Certain embedded control processors or controllers contain built-in program memory and data memory, and this memory is known as on-chip memory. So if the processor or controller already has some memory, so that type of memory is known as on-chip memory. So now we shall talk about off-chip memories. So this is the secondary memory I'm talking about, or the code memory, which is also known as ROM, the random read-only memory. Right? So this code memory is divided, you can say, classified as PROM, okay, which is also known as OTP. OTP means one-time programmable. So it is also, so the second classification is masked ROM, which is also known as MROM. So next type of code memory is EPROM. So it is EPROM on one of the code memory. And next is EEPROM. This is electrically erasable, programmable, random, read-only memory. And then next type of code memory can be NVRAM. So NVRAM is non-volatile RAM. And one more type is flash. Okay, so we shall discuss each, how they store the data, how they work, we shall see them. So program storage memory stores the program instructions, as I told, firmware. It retains its contents even after the power to it is turned off. That is what it is. These are non-volatile memories. Secondary memories are non-volatile. It is generally known as non-volatile storage. Depending on the fabrication, erasing and programming techniques, they are classified into the following. So the first one is MROM or masked ROM. So this masked ROM is one-time programmable memory. You can see I have highlighted it. So it is only one-time programmable. You cannot reprogram it. Okay, only one time. It uses hardwired technology for storing the data. And it usually comes factory programmed. Okay, it usually comes factory programmed. Example, again, I'll take the toy car. So once you purchase the toy car, so the instructions are already available in the memory that is available in the toy car. You cannot program the toy car. Okay, so it is already pre-programmed. It comes pre-programmed from the factory. So that is what is, so that in the such applications, MROM is used. Okay, so by masking and metallization process according to the data provided by the end user. So the primary advantage of this is, so it is low cost. Okay, for high volume production, it is very, very low cost. They are least expensive type of solid state memories. Right? So different mechanisms are used for masking the process of ROMs. Masking in the sense storing the data, how the data is stored. So one mechanism is creation of enhanced and or depletion mode transistors through the channel implant. So since you already know about this enhanced mode or depletion mode transistors in the CMOS VLSI design subject, so that is how can create the implant or store the data. So one more mechanism is creating the memory cell either using a standard transistor or a high threshold transistor. So this is one more mechanism of storing the data. So what is this high threshold transistor is? So it, as the name itself indicates, it has a high threshold or a breakaway voltage. So what will happen is the supply voltage required to turn on the transistor is above the normal ROM IC operating voltage. So that is what is high threshold transistors. So this ensures, so what this ensures is that the transistor is always off. So because the threshold voltage is very high and you cannot provide the voltage required to turn on the transistor, so the transistor remains always off and the memory cell stores always logic zero. So whenever you want to store a logic zero, you create a high threshold transistor, and if you want to store a logic one, you create a standard transistor with normal threshold. So this is how you can store a zero or a one in MROM. So if you want to store a zero, create a high threshold transistor which will never turn on, and hence, and it, since it never turns on, it will return logic 0. And if you want to store a logic 1, create a standard transistor with normal threshold voltage, and so which can be provided, and it turns on, and as soon as it turns on, it will store a logic 1. So the limitation with MROM based firmware storage is the inability to modify the device firmware against firmware upgrades. So what is the problem with the MROM is, once it is programmed by factory program, it cannot be changed. So suppose some updates are released, suppose the toy for the toy car, some updates are released which will have some bug fixes on the software or the firmware, so that cannot be updated by the end user because the memory is one time programmed. So this is the drawback. So since MROM is permanent in bit storage, it is not possible to alter or erase the information. This is the first type of secondary memory or the ROM. So second type is programmable ROM. So this is known as PROM, or it is also known as OTP. So one time programmable. So unlike MROM, this is not pre-programmed by the manufacturer. So this type of memory, you can purchase it from the market, and whenever you purchase it from the market, it is not pre-programmed. It is empty. Okay, empty in the sense that nothing is stored in that particular, that nothing is stored in that particular memory. So that is what is pre-programmed. Sorry, not pre-programmed, empty. Right? So whenever you purchase a memory from the market which is not pre-programmed or which is empty, so that type of memory is this OTP or programmable ROM. So why it is known as programmable? Because once you purchase the memory, you can program it. So you can write the instructions, whatever the firmware you want, you can write that instructions to the MROM, or sorry, not MROM, PROM or OTP. But why it is OTP, one time programmable? So once you write something to it, okay, once you write the firmware, you cannot erase it again. Okay, so it is, that is why it is known as one time programmable. So you purchase it, you write something to it. So once you write something to it, it is sealed. You cannot reprogram it. So think of it like a normal CD. Okay, normal compact disc. So you purchase a compact disc, you burn something to compact disc, and once you burn something to the compact disc, you cannot erase it. Okay, so that is what is one time programmable. So whenever you purchase the compact disc, it is empty, or it is not pre-programmed, it is empty, you can write anything to it. So that is what is this one. So how this is achieved is using polysilicon wires arranged in matrix. So these wires can be functionally viewed as fuses. So in such type of memories, so there are fuses. So if you burn a fuse, you can, let's say, store a 0, and if you don't burn a fuse, you can store a 1. Okay, so that is what we will see here. It is programmed by a PROM programmer. Okay, so there is a separate programmer used to program this. So suppose if you take an example of CD, so you require a CD writer for it, correct? CD writer, so like that. So this particular memory, it is known as PROM programmer. It selectively burns the fuses according to the bit pattern that needs to be stored. So if you want to store a 0, or if you want to store a 1, it depends on that. So fuses which are not blown or not burnt, so that represents a logic 1. So as I told, there are fuses arranged in terms of matrix, and whichever fuse you don't blow or whichever fuse you don't burn, that is a logic 1. So it will store a logic 1. Whereas the fuses that you burn, or the fuses that you burn, represent a logic 0. And the default state is logic 1. So it is, the fuses are not blown. Okay. So OTP is widely used for commercial production of embedded systems. So they are used for commercial production of embedded systems whose prototype version is already proven and code is finalized. So as I told you, you can burn the code only once. So you cannot reprogram it. So once you are sure that your code will work, you have tested it thoroughly, then only you should burn the code onto the PROM. So because you cannot change it once it is burnt. It is again low cost solution for the commercial production. So what is cannot be, so this is very important, cannot be reprogrammed. They are one time programmable, not reprogrammable. So next is erasable programmable read only memory. So EPROM. So now you can see, so the first we discuss MROM, which cannot be programmed at all, so it is factory programmed. Next we saw PROM, which can be one-time programmable, so it is not factory programmed, but the user can program it, but he can program it only once. That is why it is in OTP. So now we are with EPROM, which is known as erasable PROM, erasable programmable ROM. So now this can be erased and reprogrammed. So that is what is EPROM. So erasable programmable. Memory gives flexibility of reprogram the same chip. That's called reprogramming the same chip. Same chip can be reprogrammed. So this stores the information in terms of charging the floating gate field effect transistor. So the data is stored in terms of a charge. So bit information is stored by using what is known as EPROM programmer. So previously we saw PROM programmer, now it is EPROM programmer. So there is a hardware which will come, which applies high voltage to charge the floating gate. So EPROM contains a quartz crystal window for erasing the stored information. So how will you erase? Using a quartz crystal window. So if window is exposed, if this whatever the window is exposed to UV rays, ultraviolet rays, for a fixed duration, so there is a duration, let's say 20 to 30 minutes, if we expose the memory through this window, so that entire memory will be erased. So you can see here, once you expose the memory through a quartz crystal window to ultraviolet rays, the entire memory will be erased. Entire memory, okay? So even though EEPROM is flexible, that is in terms of reprogrammability, but what is the drawback is, it needs to be taken out of the circuit board. What do you mean by it? Means whatever the memory chip, it has to be taken out of the circuit and it has to be placed in the EEPROM programmer for the EEPROM programmer, which has the UV rays, and you have to expose that to 20 to 30 minutes and it will be erased. So you have to remove the memory chip outside, or you have to take it out from the circuit board. So it cannot be erased within the circuit. Okay, so it is not in system programmable. That is what is ISP. It is not ISP. Okay, fine. So next type of the ROM or secondary memory is electrically erasable. So previously we saw erasable programmable. So now it is electrically erasable. So we know that we just discussed that EEPROM can be erased using or by exposing it to UV rays, ultraviolet rays. But now this EEPROM can be erased electrically, which is more convenient. So again, memory gives flexibility to reprogram the same chip using electrical signals. So now the reprogramming is done using electrical signals. The information contained in EEPROM memory can be altered by electrical signals at register or byte level. Okay, they can be erased and reprogrammed within the circuit. This is the advantage. You need not take the memory out of the circuit and place it in a UV ray container and erase it. So it can be erased and reprogrammed within the circuit, or which is known as in circuit programming, ISP. So these chips include a chip erase mode. And in this mode, they can be erased in a few milliseconds. So see how quickly you can erase the memory compared to EEPROM. So EEPROM, it required 20 to 30 minutes to get erased. But now we can do the erasing in few milliseconds, not even seconds, milliseconds. It provides greater flexibility for this system design. The only limitation is their capacity. So the capacity of EEPROM is less compared to the standard ROM. Okay, so this is the, you can say, drawback of EEPROM. So next step of ROM is flash. So what is flash? Flash memory is a variation of EEPROM technology. Okay, it is just a variation of EEPROM technology. It combines reprogrammability of EEPROM and high capacity of standard ROM. So flash has, again, it is reprogrammable, plus it is having more capacity compared to EEPROM. So that is what is the advantage of flash. So flash is organized in terms of blocks or sectors. So So now we can think this flash as a hard disk. So in hard disk, the hard disk is organized into the sectors or partitions. So you might have seen you have different partitions, C drive, E drive, D drive, like that. So there are different sectors or pages. So flash memory stores information in again in terms of floating gate MOSFETs. Okay, so similar to what is that EEPROM. So there also we used floating gate FETs. So here also it is floating gate FETs. The erasing of memory can be done at sector level or page level. So this is very important. Erasing is done in terms of sector or page level. So that is, what is the meaning of this is, suppose you want to erase only a part of the memory, you can do it here. But that is not the case with EEPROM and EEPROM. So if you erase that, the entire chip is erased, not a particular segment. But here, you can select the sector that you want to erase, that's all. So without affecting the other sectors or pages, so other memory content will be untouched. So only certain content can be removed here. So that is what is the advantage of flash. Yeah, so each sector or page should be erased before reprogram. So suppose you want to reprogram a sector or a page, you have to first erase it and then reprogram it. That's all. So this is the brief classification of ROMs or secondary memories. So now we shall go to the primary memory. So the primary memory is RAM, or it is also known as working memory. So we shall discuss about the working memory. So RAMs. So what is this RAM? Read write memory, or it is also known as random access memory. Right? So I told this primary memories are volatile memories. So these are also known as working memories or data memories. Right? So these are volatile, meaning when power is turned off, all the contents are destroyed. So then RAM is direct access memory, meaning we can access desired memory location directly without the need of traversing through the entire memory locations to reach the desired position. So that is, so what this sentence means is, suppose you want to access, let's say, location 2000 in a particular RAM, so you can directly go to that location 2000. So you need not start with 0, then go to 1, 2, 3, 4, then you can go to location 1000, then 1500, 1600, then go to 2000, not like that. So you can directly point to 2000. So that is what is the meaning of this. So again, this RAM is classified into SRAM, DRAM and NVRAM. Okay, so NV means non-volatile RAM. So you can see SRAM is static RAM, DRAM is dynamic RAM. So you will see that. So come to the static RAM. So this static RAM stores data in form of voltage. Okay, so this stores the data in form of voltage. They are made up of flip-flops. So you already studied flip-flops. So SRAM is will consist of flip-flops. Okay, so flip-flops are nothing but storage elements. So whatever you store, suppose you store 0, that will hold the content 0. Okay, suppose if you want to store 1, it will hold the content 1 until the power is there, power supply is given to it. So in typical implementation, so a simple SRAM cell is realized using 6 transistors or 6 MOSFETs. So by the time you already know what are MOSFETs, right? So in MOSFETs there are 2 types usually. So one is N MOSFET and one more is P MOSFET. So N MOSFET is used so N MOSFET is used usually as a pull down network, and P MOSFET is usually for used for pull up network. Okay. So out of 6 transistors that are required for one cell, so 4 transistors are used for building the flip flop or the latch. Okay, and the remaining 2 are used for controlling the latch. So I'll show you the diagram. So SRAM is the fastest RAM available. Right? So which is the fastest RAM available? SRAM. So SRAM is fast in operation due to its resistive networking and switching capabilities. So now we shall see the diagram here. So this is the, you can see, what is this? The SRAM cell, how many transistors, just count here, Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, Q5, and Q6, so 6 transistors. So all these 6 transistors will comprise of a single SRAM cell. So this can hold, this arrangement can hold only one data, 1 bit data. So So either it can hold a 0 or it can hold a 1. So now we'll come to this arrangement here. So what is Q1 and Q2? So this Q1 and Q2, they are actually consist or they are implementing a inverter. So in inverter, if you remember, there are two transistors. One is PMOS and one more is NMOS. So this Q1 is the NMOS. Okay, please remember NMOS. This is NMOS and this is PMOS. Q2 is PMOS. So these two comprise one inverter. And Q3, again it is NMOS. And Q4, again it is PMOS. So I'll label it for your convenience. So this is NMOS, or you can say N-type MOSFET, and this is PMOS, P-type MOSFET. Again, so Q3, so this is NMOS, and this is PMOS. So N and a P here. So these two will consist of, or configure one inverter, and these two make up one more inverter. So they are actually connected back to back. And along with that, these Q5 and Q6, these are again N MOSFETs itself. This is N MOSFET and this is also N MOSFET. So these are control MOSFETs. Okay, so if you simplify this diagram, so this is what it will look like. So can you see this? This is the arrangement you can see here. So two inverters connected back to back. So let's say this is Q1 and Q2. This is Q3 and Q4. So these two will comprise this first inverter and this is the second inverter. So and they are connected back to back. Okay. And then they are controlled using two more transistors. So this is the NMOS transistor. This is the NMOS transistor, so which is, what is it? Q5. So this is Q5. And this is again NMOS, which is Q6 in the diagram. So these are the control transistors, and you can see the label says this is bit line B, and this is bit line B bar. Okay, so you can see here. So there are two lines. So these are the inputs as well as outputs. They act as inputs as well as output, depending on whether it's read operation you are trying to achieve or write operation. So this is bit line B, and this is bit line B bar. Okay. So how this will work? So now you'll see, suppose now it is the write operation you are doing, so you want to store a 0. Okay, so what is the data you have to store? 0. So bit line B is 0. So this is 0 you want to store. So you have to apply a 0 here, logic 0. And since this is bit line bar, so since bit line B is 0, so bit line bar will be 1, logic 1. So you are applying a 1 here and you are applying a 0 here. Okay, so then after applying 0 and 1 here, now you have to enable these two transistors, Q5 and Q6. So how will you enable these two transistors? Yes, so by applying the gate voltage. So this is the gate voltage here. You can see the gate voltage. So it is connected to the word line. So it is connected to the word line. So as soon as you assert a logic 1 on this word line, so let's say you apply 1 here and 1, and since these are N MOSFETs, they turn on. As soon as they turn on, whatever the data here, which is 0 here and this is 1 here, so it is available here now. So this 1 will be available here and this 0 is available here, since these two transistors turn on. So as soon as you enter the data, so the word line will be made 0 now. So after 1 it will be made 0, so that the transistors become off. So now, so as soon as you apply 1 here, so which is the input for this inverter, so this 1 will become 0, so that is what is here, and this 0 you apply to this inverter, it will become 1. So this is how the data is stored. Okay, so it is the write operation. So similarly, if you want to read the transistor or read the SRAM, what you have to do is, so you should not apply anything here, so just keep these lines idle. Okay, so nothing should be applied here because it is read operation, not write. So now you have to apply a 1 here on the word line so that these two transistors turn on. As soon as these two transistors are turned on, so this data is available here. So what is the data? 0. And this data is available here. So what is the data? 1. So we are bothered only about bit line B, because this is the data we are bothered. So if you read a 0 here, that means the data stored in the SRAM is 0, and if you read a 1 here, the data stored is 1. So that is what we are bothered about. Okay, this is the basic operation of SRAM, right? So now we'll move on to the DRAM or dynamic RAM. So how this will work is, so dynamic RAM stores the data in form of charge. So not the voltage, it is charge. It stores the data in terms of charge. They are made up of MOSFET transistor gates. Okay, so DRAM has its highest density and low cost compared to SRAM. Why? Because see, SRAM, in order to store one bit, we require 6 transistors. But in DRAM, that is not the case. To store one bit, you require only one transistor. Okay, so hence the density is more here. So just imagine, 6 transistors are there. So what is the area required? And if there is only one transistor, what is the area required? So that is what is core density. So since it has only one transistor, you can accommodate more cells. Okay. So the disadvantage of this is, since charge, the data is stored in terms of charge, the charge can get leaked off. Okay, with time. And to prevent this, you should have a special refresh circuits. Okay, for DRAMs. So these special refresh circuits are known as DRAM controllers. So what are they used for? They are used for refreshing operation. So the refresh operation is done periodically in milliseconds interval. So this is the diagram of a simple DRAM. You can see only one transistor is sufficient to store one bit. Okay, so you can see the word line, you can see the bit line. So it is a NMOS transistor, is it not? It is a NMOS transistor. As a NMOS transistor, suppose you want to store as a 1, what you have to apply? So you have to apply a 1 here. Okay, you have to apply 1 here. As soon as you apply 1, so you have to enable this transistor or turn on the transistor. How will you turn on an NMOS? You have to apply a 1 on the word line. As soon as you apply 1, so this 1 here is transferred to the, so suppose this is the drain, so it will be transferred to the source. Okay, so where a capacitor is there, you can see the capacitor. It will hold this charge. So what is the charge? 1. So 1, let's say it is 3 volts. So this is how you represent a 1, because it is charge, correct? So it is 1. So since this is a capacitor, once you store the data, this capacitor can drain off, okay, or can discharge. So how will you prevent this discharge? So there is no prevention, but what you have to do is, you have to continuously refresh this circuit. So let's say after 10 seconds, this charge from 3 volts, let's say, becomes 2.8 volts, because the capacitor starts discharging. So now, so let's say after 10 seconds, you have to refresh this, or you have to restore 3 volts back. Okay, from 2.8, you have to make it 3. So that is what is the job of the refreshing circuits, which are known as DRAM control, so that the charge is not lost. Okay, so hope you're getting how this DRAM works. So here is a comparison of DRAM with SRAM. So SRAM, so how many transistors it requires? 6 transistors for one cell, so or to hold one bit. But here DRAM requires only one MOSFET and one capacitor. That is sufficient to store one bit. So next is the SRAM doesn't require refreshing, because it holds the, or it stores the data in terms of voltage. DRAM requires refreshing because it holds the data in terms of a charge or charge. So next, SRAM is low capacity. Why? Because it consumes more area, because 6 transistors are required for one bit. But this is high capacity DRAM. And then SRAM is more expensive because 6 transistors are there for one bit. This is less expensive because one transistor and one capacitor is sufficient. But SRAM is faster in operation. typically the access time is 10 nanoseconds. So within 10 nanoseconds you can access the data in SRAM cell. But in DRAM, due to refresh nature, see the access time is 60 nanoseconds. So it is 6 times slower than SRAM. So that is the problem with DRAM. So now we'll move on to the third type of RAM, which is non-volatile RAM. So the name itself indicates non-volatile. As I told, RAMs are volatile, but now there are RAMs which are non-volatile also. So what is this? So this is nothing but a RAM or random access memory with certain battery backup. So there is a backup for the battery. The RAM. There is a battery which will provide the backup for the RAM. So what is the use of this battery backup? So as soon as, suppose you accidentally lose power, so if it is a normal RAM, so all the data contents are erased because it is non-volatile. But this NVRAM, it has a battery backup. So as soon as power is lost, or the direct power is lost, this battery turns on and it preserves the contents of the RAM. So that is what is the battery backup. So it is just like a UPS to your house. Okay, so that is what is this battery backup for the RAM. So it contains the SRAM again. So it is NVRAM containing, it is contains the SRAM only, but along with that it also contains a minute battery for providing supply to the memory in the absence of external power supply. So as soon as external power supply is lost accidentally, so there is a minute battery which will hold the contents of SRAM. It will not you can say erase. So the memory and the battery are packed together in a single package. So both will come in a single package. So you need not buy the battery separately. So NVRAM is used for non-volatile storage of results of operations or setting up for flags, etc. So the lifespan of this NVRAM is around 10 years. So one example is given for the NVRAM, which is DS1744 from the manufacturer is Maxim or Dallas. So how much is the memory? 32 KB. Okay, so kilobytes. Yeah, so this is about the memories that are used in the embedded systems. So this is the lecture 2. So we shall conclude this lecture 2. So in the next lecture we shall talk about sensors and actuators that are used in embedded systems.